Two-part series. Can you guys hear me good? Yes. Nice. This is an event that we've put together through the help of the Rhode Island Council for the Humanities and in collaboration with the Rhode Island, Newport Chamber of Commerce and of course the Newport Historical Society, which allowed us to hang out here this evening. I am super honored and excited to be here because in 2015 I interned at the Historical Society. And during that time, after I was done with my main assignment, I had the privilege of doing some very preliminary research on some incredible artifacts that were found in this very building
that we're in the background here.
How many of you guys have wondered about the Wanton Lyman Hazard House before?
Jeez.
Right? Have you ever sat at Empire and looked across the street and just wondered, like, what's in there? I have done that for the last 11 years that I've been in Rhode Island, and then once I actually got to do some research on the house, realized how much incredible history is inside of it. You guys know me, I'm a little bit of a history buff, but what I think is the most incredible thing about this house, and Ruth will tell you a little bit more about some of the other history, but it's the fact that there were spiritual artifacts found in this house that were credited back to the enslaved folks that lived in, unlike the southern plantation system where you had people living in separate enclaves from the main house, here in Newport when folks were enslaved, they lived in the same house. It's an urban environment and it obviously lent itself to a very different dynamic between people. And the artifacts here that were found were cowrie shells that were obvious in their origin. I hadn't done the research to exactly figure out where they were from, but they were African origin, excuse me, and there were African trade beads, as well as some human artifacts. So it's an extremely interesting collection of items, and they were collected in fabric. So they were wrapped in this little bundle called an mpizi, and that is a spiritual manifestation bundle, and it is associated with West African religious systems that are really under-researched and under-explored, and I'm not an expert in it, but I had the privilege of even trying to figure out where this came from and did some fabric analysis on the stuff that surrounded this mpizi to date it roughly to the beginning of the 1700s or so, mid-1700s, that's a long time ago for me. But anyway, this is an incredible building. They do tours here and everything, and Ruth will tell you more about it, but I'm just so honored to be here and I'm a little nervous, so don't mind me. But our second part of this series will be happening in late October, and it will be the theme for it will be Afrofuturism. So you'll notice a spectrum here. We're in the past exploring BIPOC people in this site in Newport through the history of this place. And then in our next episode, so to speak, we'll be exploring how to project our ideas of what it is like to live together in a Newport that is very diverse in the future.
And so with that, I want to also mention that part of this project, the back end of it, is sending out a survey to as many cultural institutions in Newport as possible to ask them what their timeline is and what they're doing for their anti-racism work. So even if they don't have a plan, they're going to be asked, and perhaps they will ask someone else within their organization what their plan is for their anti-racism work, because as you guys know, it is the time for it. So with that, I'm going to pass the mic to Ruth, and we have some fantastic performers coming up and scholars as well. I'm so excited to have Pete Stokes here, and Jose Losada will be performing or showing us a projection of his dance and the purpose of his topic. And then we have Christopher Johnson, who's an incredible performer as well. Thank you guys all for being here. Stay safe. The safer we stay, the more we get to do this, and the sooner we'll come out of this. All right, cheers.
Place for this kind of exploration here in Newport. You are sitting basically in Newport's oldest neighborhood. It was occupied before Europeans arrived. Preachers, revolutionaries, and loyalists, and people of European and of African descent, and the spirit bundle that Tracy mentioned is now on display at the National Museum of African American History and Culture. It is that rare an artifact, and we were really, really excited to find it. Such a tangible connection to people in their culture that you just don't see that often. And like the rest of Newport, the future of this house is not charted. And we look forward to the continuation of this project and to whatever is going to happen here next. If you want to know more, you can follow us on our website and our social media. It's basically Newport History. The website's newporthistory.com and .org, sorry. And thank you all for being here.
Programming, educational, and curriculum that's currently under developed across the state and hopefully will be unveiled later in 2021. So I'm going to try to simultaneously talk and also run this projector. So we'll see how that works. The title Creative Survival was coined in 1984 by Ms. Rowena Stewart, the founder of the Rhode Island Black Heritage Society, which started here originally in Newport and later Providence. Creative Survival tells the story of not chattel property, not the enslaved, not slaves, but of African heritage men, women, and children, and how they persevered. In fact, slavery is not black history. Black history is how African heritage men, women, and children survived and thrived despite slavery. And we call that today creative survival. So I'm going to spend 18 minutes introducing you to the history of African men, women, and children in Newport over a 300-year period. And let me basically really convey that if anything that I say very quickly tonight, please remember these three statements. We all know that we all came to the midst of a worldwide epidemic, but we're also in the middle of a worldwide Black Lives Matter and social justice movement. But what's absolutely essential in this movement is to hear the voices of African heritage people, black people. This is our time, this is our story, and this is our opportunity to make history in Newport, in Rhode Island, in America, and across the world better for all. And one of the most important aspects of this is, in this presentation, you're not going to hear the stories of African heritage and history through the interpretation of the colonizers or the white community. You're going to hear from the actual black voices. And hopefully the black voices of Newport that you hear from yesterday and today will inspire you to listen a little bit more carefully of the young black voices today who are pushing for an agenda of why black lives matter and why black history matters. And anytime I do presentations, and unfortunately it's a lot of Zoom presentations, I have to begin not with slavery or the arrival of Africans to Newport or Rhode Island or to British North America as slaves, but the very fact that African heritage and history begins well before European colonization. And in fact, for thousands of years, African kingdoms, tribes had well-identified culture, trade, language, religion, all the things that would establish a series of civilized men, women, and families on a continent well before European colonization. And what's most important to understand, that those that were captured and brought here as slaves did not arrive as blank slates. In fact, the term that we're now using today are forced immigrants. Why? Because when you think of a term of an immigrant, they arrived with their language, their culture, their religion, their foodstuffs, their labor. Well, so did the Africans. And what you're going to hear tonight in a very short period of time are how those Africans, even though arriving in the worst circumstance, enslaved, still brought with them their African identity, their religion, their culture, their music, their language, and most importantly, their labor. And in Rhode Island's case, and this becomes very important because there's lots of embellishment about who were slave traders, how many came, in Newport versus Providence versus Bristol. Here are the facts. What we now know, that there are at least between 1705 and 1807, 934 documented slaving voyages, meaning voyages of ships running from Rhode Island to West Africa, to the West Indies, and eventually back to Rhode Island, that carried a variety of products and goods, but also carried enslaved human beings. It could be several, it could be several hundred. So we now know that there are 934 documented ships. 672 came from Newport alone before the American Revolution. So if you're talking in terms of scale and participation, it is Newport. Newport is one of the most active trading ports in British North America, and Newport's at the very center in its merchants in the transportation of enslaved Africans. Most of those Africans were taken via West Africa to the Middle Bath, through the Middle Passage, and would land in the West Indies. Several would eventually make its way to Newport. And the story that you're going to hear today are those men, women, and many times children who would make their way and survive via the Middle Passage and eventually land in Newport. And again, think in terms of logic. We are British North America at that time. We're not Spanish, we're not Dutch, we're not Portuguese. So from a logical perspective, we're trading with other British settlements. So in the case of West Africa at that time, of the 18th century, it's the Gold and Guinea and Windward Coast, but particularly the Gold Coast. That's where British slave ports, British trading activity is going on. Today, the Gold Coast is largely gone. So when you think in terms of the logic of where Africans would originate from, for the most part, Africans that arrived in Newport, Rhode Island, and New England largely originated from what is today Ghana, many from Ashanti and Fanti tribes. And then eventually, those who would be transported through the Middle Passage would land in other British colonies in the West Indies, Barbados in the 17th century, Jamaica in the 18th century, and then smaller amounts in Bahamas and Antigua. But for the most part, Rhode Island's connection to the transatlantic trade is the Gold Coast, Barbados, Jamaica, and then eventually back to Rhode Island, and specifically within Newport. And what's most important is, and I had the honor last year to be invited by the Historical Society of Ghana and the University of Cape Coast to spend 2 weeks at Ananabo, which is about 30 kilometers north of Accra, the capital, and visit Fort William. Fort William is a part of a string of slave fortresses along the Canadian coast. The three most important slave fortresses that are directly connected to Newport, where Newport ships landed, and Africans were captured, and then transported to the West Indies and some back to Rhode Island, are at the Cape Coast Castle, Elmina, and most importantly, Fort William at Ananabo. My own ancestor came via Fort William to Jamaica and then eventually here. But being physically at Fort William at Ananabo, it was extraordinary for me as a Rhode Islander, someone of African heritage, to see records that directly tied to some of the most well-known families in Newport, like Rivera, Lopez, Wanton, Burns, all actively trained. But what was most important for me to be there and to learn was is that the Africans that arrived here, as I said earlier on, didn't come as a blank slate. And one of the most important, and it still exists to this day, African tradition is the day-naming tradition. The Akan people, then, as they do today, have a tradition that the day of the week or the birth order that you're born, you're given a day name. So in the case of boys born on Friday, it's Kofi, K-O-F-I, like the late Secretary General of the United Nations, Kofi Amen. We phonetically, or we anglicize that to pup or puppy. There are literally hundreds and hundreds of puppies in colonial Newport, thousands in colonial New England, and tens of thousands in places like Jamaica. And again, if you're a girl on Monday, it's Judy or a joke. What's most important is that today, by going back and looking at the records of Rhode Island Historical Society, Newport Historical Society, there are thousands of day names of Africans that once lived, worked, worshipped, and eventually died in colonial Rhode Island, and particularly Newport, in time to their day names. And if you ever want to have a chance to go to a physical place to see those actual day names, is to visit Goswell Lakers section of the Common Burying Ground. We are blessed here in Newport of having one of the oldest and largest existing African burying grounds in America, right here in Newport. We have nearly 300 markers, many of them that reflect 18th century Africans. And lo and behold, those 18th century markers have names like Kujo, which is Kojo, a day name for Thursday. Or they'll have markers like the center, Violet, wife of Cape Coast Castle, Gold Coast, Ghana, and James. Or in this case, Hector Butcher. He died 300 years ago in August from Barbados. So again, if you want to have a chance to actually see and physically experience existing historic structures that represent early African, not African American, African people, please visit Goswell Lakers. And one of the most important things that these Africans did once they arrived, they organized. Because again, many of them arrived with a shared language, shared tribal customs, shared political systems that they brought with them. And by 1780, for the first time in the Western Hemisphere, a group of African men came together here in Newport and formed the Free African Union Society. Now, how do we know this? Because Ruth Taylor has the original minute books in collections in her collection. And these African men did three important things. One, they created probably the world or the country's first census. They took any demographic information they could compile, birth, death, labor, religion, names, children, and kept a record of that. The second thing they did was they worked hard to eventually create an African school. And then the third thing is many of them wanted to return to Africa. And several did, but not until 1826. But what's most important is the first African Union Society begins not in Philadelphia, not Boston, not Savannah, Georgia, but right here in Newport. And those original records still exist as a part of the Newport Historical Society. And what's exciting for me, being a Newporter, my kids are ninth generation here. So growing up with this history and this heritage is the African Union Society in Newport would reach out to fellow Africans in Philadelphia, Providence, and Boston and say, hey, we've got an idea. Why don't you organize? Every single one of those communities between 1780 and by 1790 would establish African Union societies. Why do we know this? Because they kept records and they actually sent letters and they interacted with each other. And in fact, today, in Newport, the African Union Society would eventually evolve into a church, which is the Colored Union Congregational Church. The second building still stands at 49 Division Street. In Providence, it is the Cognon Street Baptist Church, which evolved in 1819 from the African Union Society of Providence. Their second building still stands on Cognon Street. In Philadelphia, the first two black churches in America, the African Episcopal Church of St. Thomas and the Mother Bethel African Methodist Episcopal Church, all evolved from the African Union Society. What's really neat for me as a nerd, these African men, they're talking back and forth with each other. They're talking about, so now that we're free, let's establish a church. What should it be like? How do we name it? What do we do with the school? How do we deal with the issue of so many of us still enslaved? I mean, by reading these letters, I have a first-person black voice that helps me understand how people that looked like me were thinking in 1780 or 1800. And it's not from a white interpretation. It's from black people with black voices in black history. And it all begins right here. And the Union Colored Congregational Church would spin off a whole series of new black churches in Newport, which very few people even recognize. By 1845, at Johnson Court, off of West Broadway, or what do we call it today now? Marcus Wheaton Boulevard, I always have to catch up with name changes. The Mount Zion Amy Church is established, and later it moves to Zion Place behind the Hebrew Cemetery. It's a parking lot now on Bellevue Avenue. The Civil War ends. African Americans are now moving north and now are looking for a Baptist religion, and they establish the Shiloh Baptist Church at 7311 Street, which is today Memorial Boulevard, which would have been adjacent to what is today Sardella's. Being a Newporter, you always have to give like these different kind of locations and people say, oh, that's where they are. So 11th Street would have been Memorial Boulevard, and Shiloh Baptist Church would have been next to Sardella's. Later it moves to School Street, and that building still stands, and it occupies that. Then even later, by 1902, Oliver Baptist Church, 79 Main Street, and by 1980, those churches all merge and become today the Community Baptist Church at Marcus Wheaton Boulevard. I'm stuck in the 18th century.
The building next to church is fucking old.
But I also want to recognize the ladies, because as the African men would form a Free African Union Society, by 1808 into 1809, a group of African women led by Arbor Tanner would organize and establish the Free African Female Benevolent Society in Newport and correspond with their African female correspondents in Boston and Philadelphia. The African women in Newport's initial focus was, let's get a school built. Let's make sure that our children are educated. And by 1808, in March of that year, Newport, along with Boston, almost simultaneously establishes the first free African schools in America. Now, how do we define that as an African school that's free? It's African run, the teachers are African, and the management and oversight are African. And it's Boston and Newport that begin that process, and the leaders of the effort, raising the money of that effort, are African women like Arbor Tanner and others. Later, if you want to ask questions or follow up with me with an email, Arbor Tanner's best friend was Phyllis Wheatley. Phyllis Wheatley is today recognized as the first African female poet in America. There are 10 existing letters between those women who are not talking about slavery. They're talking about what was life like to be an African woman who's free in 18th century America. A black voice that's available for us to interpret and appreciate today. And by the 19th century in Newport, things begin to change. And one of the great challenges that Newport faces is, because of British occupation at the end of the American Revolution, it really runs into a real economic slump. There's no industrial revolution here. There are only two mills along the waterfront. And for the most part, in the antebellum area up until the end of the Civil War, Newport is not as dynamic. There is still a black community, and they are still focused on critical issues within Newport. But it's after the Civil War, with the beginnings of what becomes the resort economy in the Gilded Age, that things begin to pick up. But also in Rhode Island, generally at that time, there's a real concern that the Jim Crow laws that are taking root in post-Civil War South are seeping into the North in New England in what we call Jim Crow traditions. And let me be very clear, whereas there was not outward discrimination and racism as compared to South Carolina and Virginia, African Americans now in 19th century post-Civil War Rhode Island still were fighting for basic rights of livelihood, employment, education. So there are a group of African-American leaders, men and women in Providence and Newport, to begin organizing. Two of the most important are Newporters, George Thomas Downing and Reverend Malon Van Horn, who was the Reverend of the Union Colored Congregational Church. George Thomas Downing was one of the wealthiest black men of the time. He was a protege of Frederick Douglass and Senator Charles Sumner. And George Downing, in his wealth, owned one of the largest hotel properties. It was burned down twice on Bellevue Avenue, across from today is Turtle Park. In fact, there is a Downing Street, his name owned that entire block. If I could take you back to late 19th century Newport, most of Bellevue Avenue, from where the Art Museum is, and running to what is today Memorial Boulevard and the Travelers Block, were black-owned businesses. And there were three black places of worship in that area. What we today call Historic Hill and Top of the Hill were largely black middle-class neighborhoods, as was Beacon Hill in Boston, and as was College Hill in Benefit Street in Providence. Little things like gentrification, redlining kind of changed them. But what's most important is George Downing leads the effort of integration of schools in Rhode Island. He leads the effort of supporting black business and commerce in Rhode Island. And Reverend Van Horn, who's my own ancestor, in 1872 becomes the first African-American to sit on a school board in Newport and called for the integration of schools and the hiring of black teachers. In 1885, he passes, with George Downing and others, the state's first Civil Rights Act. And then in 1885, he's elected as the first black state representative in Rhode Island. A man of the cloth, but a man of political will and interest. And these men are all interacting right here within our community. And they're sharing these programs, they're sharing political astuteness with counterparts in Boston, New York, Connecticut, and Philadelphia. It's an extension of what happened in the 18th century with the African Union Society. And Reverend Van Horn, I'm biased because he's an ancestor. In 1887, he wrote a series of narratives which he called The Negro Rebellion's Past, Present, and Future. We still own those narratives. We put them on loan to the Rhode Island Black Heritage Society, Rhode Island Historical Society, and we just brought them back. And if anyone has an interest, we digitized it, we can send it out to you because it's quite long. It's a bit of a sermon. But most importantly, he gives a black voice and a viewpoint of the state of black people in 1887. Their past, he talks about the history, the present, the challenges that we're overcoming coming out of the Civil War, and the future. And I just want to read the center statement because this really connects with Newport. Because in Newport, we're so rightfully proud of being established under what we call religious freedom. But what's important to understand, the tenets of religious freedom were not available only to Protestant Christian men. If you were not a Protestant Christian male, you could not enjoy the full benefits of citizenship in early Rhode Island, and certainly Newport. And he points that out. He talks about the fact that the Negroes landed in America not to catch the spirit of liberty and religious freedom, which the Puritans expected. He was to be an entirely different experience. The Puritan would be schooled with things that would draw out his self-reliant individuality and all matters pertaining to manhood. The Negro was to live in a Christian home and upon the rich plantation of Rhode Island. And of now the favored pilgrim, yet the Negro's impressed with the fact by teachers and schools, the pulpit and the press, his destiny to be the hero of wood. Doesn't that sound exactly what the Black Lives Matter movement is calling for today, in the recognition today? So if you ever want a chance to hear a black voice then, read what Van Horn and others had said, and it will be eerily connected to what the Black Lives Matter movement demands on today. And again, I just want to point out with the women, because as George Downing and Reverend Van Horn and others were doing their work, Black women, powerful Black women, were doing their work right here in Newport. By the end of the 19th century into the 20th century, a group of Black women in Newport and Providence begin to establish a series of colored women's clubs. One of the earliest is the Newport Women's League. That league is established by Mary H. Dickinson, who owns a dress shop on Traveler's Block. She owns properties across Newport. The Women's League headquarters still exists on Gould Street. She's one of the wealthiest women. And she, along with other Black women across New England, would form these clubs to focus on the three critical issues of the day: anti-lynching laws, women worker rights, making sure that women of color had equal access to jobs, particularly during the war years of World War I, and then most importantly, the suffragette movement. And these women, such as in the center, the Mary Elizabeth Rice, a top Dr. Rice, Roberta Dunbar, Mary Dickinson, these were leading Newport and Providence women who were leading the effort of civil rights, equal rights, and anti-lynching, and leading a national effort right here in this community, right here in this city. And unfortunately, their names are largely unknown in history books. And as I said before, Mary Dickinson today is recognized as one of the leading proponents of Black women's rights. And this is well before the establishment of urban leagues, the Deltas, or the NAACP. So I'm going to end here, because this is an arts program, and I'm right at the 20-minute mark. And I want to be able to also recognize that, as Black folks, we had fun in this town. There was an entire summer crowd of Black folks from Philadelphia, Baltimore, Washington, New York, and Boston who would come here and have a great time in Newport. And I'm just going to give you a short inkling of who was here and some of the events that were going on. William Stanley Braithwaite, by the end of the 19th and into the 20th century, was the most well-known Black poet and literary agent in America. In fact, he would go on to be a professor of literature and poetry at Atlanta University. He would then leave by the 1920s and help establish in Harlem, as a part of the Harlem Renaissance, the art and culture scene. He summered in Newport on DuBois Street, right off of Bellevue Avenue. And this is something from my family collection. He would set up a series of literary societies for the Black community so that particularly young Black children could have access to culture and literacy. And in this particular event, and women get really mad at me about this, this is a group of African-American men who are coming together to debate the topical issue of that time on the mental capacity of the sex is equal. My grandfather's there, my great-uncle's there, so that women don't get mad at me. My grandmother and great-aunt were college-educated. I can assure you, if my grandfather and great uncle were going home that night, they had the right answer to that question. But what's most important here is that Black men are coming together and talking about the topical issue of that day. I have dozens of pamphlets of these Black men and later Black women, my great great aunt and others, talking about these issues. So despite the prevailing discrimination or Jim Crow traditions of isolation, they still lived their lives, enjoyed their literacy, enjoyed their culture, and passed it on to their families. And this comes from the picture of Edward Bannister, comes from the collection around Black Heritage Society. In the picture of Edward Bannister at Battery Park in Newport, taking a painting, is incredibly important. Edward and Christian Bannister of Providence, some of you in Newport. Edward is one of the leading Black artists of his time. He's one of the early founders of what becomes the Art Club of Providence. He is today recognized as probably one of the leading and earliest Black portrait artists. And he spent a significant amount of time in Providence and Newport. In fact, in time in Newport, he was running art classes within the Black community, in most cases through the Black churches, Mount Olivet Baptist Church and Shiloh Baptist Church. So again, what's important to understand, these are things that are going on in the 1890s and early 20th century. Unfortunately, for most people of African heritage at that time, they're trying not to be lynched. they're dealing with day-to-day oppression and isolation and discrimination. But here, there's this one area of respite where black people can live their lives as openly and honestly and collectively as they could possibly be in early America. And it's happening right here within this community of Newport. And the final one I just want to offer, this is a fun one of ours, is Abby Mitchell. Abby Mitchell was the leading black soprano opera singer. She's probably today known as the lead singer of the opening of Porky and Bess in 1935. But she was such a favorite, and she loved coming to Newport. Mrs. Vanderbilt would invite her several times to perform at the Casino Theater, which is a part of the Tennis Hall of Fame today. Abby Mitchell was actively engaged in providing singing lessons for some of the black children in the churches of Newport. So think about that. You've got one of the most famous soprano singers in the country at that time coming to your local church and providing singing lessons to your children. That wasn't happening in Atlanta or Washington or Boston, but it was happening right here in Newport. We're fortunate to have it. And I just want to end here because, again, African Heritage Men and Women.
This whole week, I was like involved in deep conversations about everything that's surrounding with Breonna Taylor. Because a wall got shot 12 times or 21 times, the officer got indicted for shooting a wall 12 times, but nobody got indicted for murdering a woman that was sleeping in her bed. Whole other story. And I was talking to some friends, and I was just thinking to myself, I'm tired. I'll be 50 on my next birthday. I remember these conversations, we were having them in the 90s. I remember in New York when it was Adeline Louima, Amadou Diallo, and Eleanor Bumpers. They all happened within a short amount of time, and we were having these conversations. And my whole purpose of doing what I do is because I don't want my daughter to have these conversations. Like, I just don't want this to, I want it to end. And that's the reason I do what I do. So I apologize to Tracy earlier because she gave me an assignment and I failed. instead, I was thinking about one of the reasons why this continuously happens is because black skin is criminalized and dehumanized. And in order for you to do these things to people who are actually human, that means you don't see us like you see your daughter, or you see your father, or you see anything. So I failed on the assignment because I wanted to try to write something that was a little bit more humanizing for black people than, not saying it wasn't gonna be humanizing, but.
You did a great job, don't worry
about it. Yeah. Here we go. Before I realized that I was gonna have daughters, I had this vision of giving my daughters the type of diamonds that would make any suitor have to compete with their dad to prove their love for my daughters. No matter how much I wanted my firstborn to be a son, it's possible that maybe I always knew that I would have girls. I was told, we know our whole lives before we even come to this plane of existence. I don't know who said it first, some ancestor on some ethereal plane, astral plane, before my Kaaba took physical form, or some magic woman weaving the wisdom into my first breath while placing my foot to the dirt to uncover my real name. The caveat is, though we choose our parents, our circumstances, our hardships, blessings, and lessons that we are to learn before we're even born. While we are piloting these bodies, the only real conflicts we have is not accepting the course we chose to travel before we got here. To me, that explains a lot. I've been thinking a lot about my death lately. I promised my firstborn daughter that I would never take my own life. So that is not an option when it comes to my death. My therapist asked me, well, what about the day when taking your own life becomes reality? What will you do then? I said, I will refuse to move. She said, but what about when it's not enough and you just want to die? And I almost fired her on the spot. But instead, I took a breath, realizing that I chose to be here and chose to be asked that question, and said, you don't understand the love I have for my daughters. I hold no secrets and tell them everything, shielding her from nothing about me. Even the parts that society stigmatizes and shuns. I am raising a black woman. She needs to know not everyone loves her, not even black men. And if she is to know the truth, if she is to know truth and love, it will come from her father. It may have been wrong to say, but I told her, she is the only reason I choose to walk on this planet. One day she asked me, what was I most afraid of in life? I told her, my biggest fear is losing you. The day you crowned my universe, you became my world. When I asked her what was her biggest fear in life, she replied, you're driving. She said, I'm not afraid that you will kill yourself because you promised me that. But how you drive, I will lose you. And you promised me that you would never take your own life no matter how bad you feel. You said you will always be around to catch me if I fall. So I'm not afraid of you killing yourself. I'm afraid of your driving taking you away from me. My daughter and I, we love each other a lot. She always says she loves me more than I will ever know. That is why at a very young age, I told my daughter she is magic. I feel it's a huge disservice to all black girls if at a young age you do not tell them that they are magic. If we do not let them know that this magic is a continuation secret handed down from generations that stretch all the way back to Africa, we are doing them a disservice. This concept is not lost on me, mainly because it was a black woman that told me there is magic in a black man's smile. People complain to me that in photos, I don't smile. It's because you will never see the magic in my smile if you never see me in a photo with my daughters. Truth is, I am always smiling, but I have to hide the magic though. So to see me smile, you have to look into my eyes. It's the only place I have to hide my magic without fear of losing my life. As crazy as my driving may be, the magic in a black man's smile is what drives white men with badges crazy enough to murder them. The magic in a black man's smile, historically in America, drives white people crazy, period, in many different forms. I was told as a child by many a black woman that a black man's smile is magic. I was told, how can a black man's smile be anything less than that who gave him entry into this paradigm? We are all mirrors, complete yet shattered in many different pieces, reflecting generational curses to be broken so that when those who come after us appear whole. As a woman and a man together reflect infinity, their progeny's first input is the mother. So the child reflects the mother. The first taste of intimacy a child has is suckling from its creator, its universe. And like I have learned to publicly conceal my joy in ways that only those who intimately know me can see, if you ever witness the eyes of a black baby when cradled in its mother's arms, close to heart, you know, even with a mouthful, the baby is smiling. Because of the sins of the father, America fears this connection so much that whenever the word black is followed by magic, boogeyman, and pariahs are Picassoed in the frontal lobes, the center of creativity, the house of imagination in every American human, and sometimes even those that inherently wear the jacket of fitting the description. For all the power that black magic holds, it cannot stop the powers that be who camouflage white power in black robes and blue uniforms from making Jason Pollock asphalt and concrete portraits of the most powerful beings, the scientifically proven first persons to walk their planet. Black magic cannot help but to become art for social media galleries and current news exhibits. I don't know if you heard the legends of the flying Africans or of Igbo landing. It is said that while in the belly of the capitalist sea monster, colonizers named the schooner or the Morova, funny how people who nitpick and exasperate the smallest missteps of black people, making them lifelong skin color criminalizing stigmas that transform into stereotypes, can overlook the historical significance of keeping their own records straight. Anyways, a planter, captured and traded for something scaled at less than the weight of a feather of his devotion, prayed to Anansi, the wisest of them all, for a way out of this predicament. Anansi, seeing the Igbo people closest to Anansi's heart, far, far from home and barren, bearing no offerings for the help requested, took pity on them and paid them a visit. Rumored to be able to escape any trap, Anansi, wisest of them all, warned them of what lies ahead instead of freeing them in. When the ship landed at St. Simon's Island, the Igbo turned east and walked back to Africa over the water. Oyimbos, that's white folks for layman people, called it a mass suicide. But those who know say the Igbo flew across the water all the way back to Africa. To this day, no one knows what actually happened to those people. Or maybe you heard of the unbreakable spirit of black people. In the unbearable southern summer heat, black folks crouched in fields of miniature puffs of clouds, pricked fingers picking the crops, keeping the white pristine, never spilling one crimson drop while meeting quotas. Masters and overseers alike, amazed at the magic that bellowed from black bodies and blanketed the silence. Instead of having the misery of enslaved people, they toiled in somber, day after day, absorbing the cruelty of their captors, surviving long enough to see the future generations come to fruition. Maybe that's why Al Jolson was called the greatest entertainer of his time. Knowing he was lacking, being that he could not gain passage to displaying the magic of a black woman, attempted to capture the magic in a black man's smile. Covering his countenance with a concoction of charcoal and petroleum jelly, he stretched red lipstick wide from cheek to cheek, trying to mock that which he could not covet. There is magic in our melanin, giving us strength, allowing us to become continuations of the secrets that came before us. In Kesey's are objects that spirits inhabit. A tradition stemming from the Congo, Kaaba is Egyptian, a compound word made up of Ka and Ba. The Ka is the part of you that is the old soul, that the you that has existed before and before again. The Ba is the new soul. When we inhabit these bodies, we are not only newborns, but continuations of our ancestors. If I was a betting man, I would bet, found in the Kesey cloth, there is the magic of a black man's smile. That the spirits decided now is the time to remind us that we are continuations of more than generational trauma being played on repeat in the soundtrack of oppression of the oppressed. Our magic is not of this place, but it is in this place. We have the secrets and the answers. We just have to remember. So that's my piece. Yeah.
About you guys, but I haven't had the chance to experience a night like this in Newport before, and I want to thank all the artists who participated, everyone who's here. We had, I don't know what that was, but you guys are all here because you believe that Black Lives Matter. That was part of the theme that we broadcasted for this evening, right? But there is that, I don't know how to say this other than that. That is just the start. We all know that Black Lives Matter. And what we really need to start doing is cherishing each other for the skills that we bring and the people that we are. And I love hearing the history of people on a deep level, their actual stories. You know, we're often judged just by our appearance and whether or not that's for the better or the worse. You know, I have a lot of personal privilege and I think that this site really does represent people coming to this place involuntarily and holding on to their culture, to their belief, to their religious systems, and obviously sitting in the attic of this space around that chimney and talking about their spirits, their ancestors, their futures, what matters to them, what their favorite items are and what they mean. You can imagine being on a ship, I'm a sailor, being in the hold for a couple months and holding on to one little trade bead for months, and then saying, you know, this represents something really deep to me. So I actually asked all of you guys to bring three trinkets. If you did, that's awesome. If you didn't, you can still participate in this little exercise that I'd like to finish the night with, which is a sort of visualization. Essentially, if you have three trinkets, or you can think of three items in your home that really matter to you, and I want you to think of the oldest one of those. So whether or not it's your grandmother's brooch, or perhaps a seashell that you found when you were five, or a drawing that someone gave to you when you were little, or whatever it ends up being, I want you to think about that object. And if you can, just infuse it with the person that you were in the past. So what were your ideas in the past about people? You know, when you pass a black man in the street at that age, how do you feel? No judgment. Maybe a little bit of judgment, but now no judgment, okay? Just because you're exploring this about yourself. Did you look that person in the eye and see the smile? That is a beautiful thing that if you start doing, you'll actually start to notice. And if you didn't, why not? And if you didn't, forgive yourself and start now. So it's kind of hard, but just let yourself be like, yeah, I crossed the street, or I looked down, or I was afraid. Fine, that's marketing. You're part of marketing. It's a powerful, powerful thing, okay? So take your second artifact, and hopefully this is something that's a little bit closer to who you are today. Perhaps you just picked up a rock on the way over here because you're like, I'm supposed to bring artifacts to this thing. Perfect, okay? In that artifact, I want you to be okay and kind of center yourself in this work. So the next time you pass a black man or a black family in the street, try to acknowledge them. I know it sounds so stupid, but it happens. Just like, try. And the next time you're at a planning meeting at the city of Newport and someone gets up and is super upset, just try to understand how someone could get that upset. I'll relate a personal story really quickly. So we're obviously in a pandemic right now, and people were also going out and protesting because they're getting shot in their homes. And I got into so many debates on social media about people going out during a pandemic, and that's not safe. And now this thing is spreading. And I just had to be like, look, how upset would you have to be so petrified of a pandemic and still need to do this? And it's not a hard question. You're a human being and they're human beings and we're all human beings. So how afraid would you have to be that something like this scares you less? I mean, it scares you more than a pandemic, you know? It's really something to sit with. So the final artifact that I ask you guys to kind of pick up maybe on your way home is the future artifact, right? So you're doing this work. You're going back to your own place of employment and you're asking them, hey, why aren't we diverse here? You know, what can I do to help bring more people onto the board of this organization that have more diverse views? What are we doing for anti-racism work? You know, the city of Newport had a really hard time just making it mandatory to have anti-racism work occur there. That's nuts. We all need it. Like I said, 400 years of marketing is really hard to undo. And I will just end it there with that. I think there's a lot of hope for us to move forward, and that events like these can help us do it together. And I think stop judging yourselves and stop thinking and start thinking about how you react and what your future reactions are going to be and how you can stand up for folks and look people in the eye. This has kind of been a little bit of like a lot of info, and I recognize that. I kind of want us to all celebrate. Jesus Andujar, thank you so much for drumming for us today. Thank you. Thank you, Jose Losada, for your beautiful choreography piece. I really appreciate it. Island Company, and also a wonderful drummer with Common Sense Music. Yeah. And tell me what your solo act is called.
Jesus Andujar.
Huh?
Jesus Andujar.
What?
Jesus Andujar.
Oh, okay. Jesus Andujar. Yeah, look him up. But also amazing drumming. And then thank you, Keith and Christopher, for both being here. Nycole Fabelous is also here. She's a local artist in Newport. She's been drawing this experience. And hopefully, if you guys have any feedback or anything that you come up with, like if you have a realization, like hit me up. You know, honestly, if you're like, you know, I need to do something, I want to be a bigger part of this movement, Newport, has things going on, but it's small. Like, let's make something happen that's more visible. The Black Lives Matter protest is wonderful, but that's just the beginning. So I want to thank you guys again for coming out and hope that we can all gather soon again. Come to the next one. We'll have Afrofuturism at the United Congregational Church at 72 Collins Street in late October. And then we'll be talking to people who imagine BIPOC folks on spaceships, which if there are going to be spaceships, we're going to be on them, okay? We might be the designers of them, you know? So that'll be really fun, and there'll be a lot of music and that sort of thing, because it'll be in our own space. But also thank you to the Newport Historical Society for letting us be here, and to Common Fence Music for sponsoring the event with our help.
Yeah. I'm sorry.